This Steve Jones Show podcast is now loading. The Steve Jones Show podcast is presented by Sunbury Motor Company, Purdy Insurance, Brewers Outlet, and NIL Game Changers. Bringing you an in-depth look at Penn State sports and more, this is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. The Steve Jones Show is presented by Brewers Outlet, NIL Game Changers, Sunbury Motor Company, and Purdy Insurance. Now from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
I was listening to the news and they said they were attempting to rescue a loon, so I texted Todd, is the suit all right? No?
Yeah, he's okay.
Wrong loon?
Wrong loon. That loon had wings, I think.
Just asking for friends. Didn't want anybody in the audience to panic. Over there in Turbotville. Is the suit all right? You okay? Today's show, this half hour, brought to you by Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. Ford, Kia, Hyundai, best in new inventory, all with great warranties. Great pre-owned inventory. The all-important Sunbury Motors guarantee, because they go over every vehicle with a fine-tooth comb. It really eases the buying experience. And then, for the life of the vehicle, a great service department. Routine, difficult, they handle it all at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury, Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. As promised, a sit-down 101 with Cale Sanderson, talking about his team, and also about the importance of that gap between the end of the regular season with Edinburgh and the Big Ten Championships at Maryland this weekend.
Yeah, we just want to make sure that our kids know that we're ready to go and that we're confident. And you know, most of the work's been done, so now it's just about just getting ready to compete. And I think, you know, this group is very, very competitive. We've talked about that over the years. And the bigger the match, the more excited they are. So, yeah, it's more about just kind of leading in that final link to where they can just kind of trust what they've been doing and themselves, and just know they're ready to go, which they are.
Right. It doesn't mean there haven't been challenges along the way. Part of the challenges that you've had to deal with this year as a team and the staff is illness, and also along the way, you know, guys will get bumped up. What has that done to test the depth of the team because of, you know, because you've battled through a series of illnesses this year?
Yeah, we have. I feel like every year you have something, and every week when you're preparing for a duel, the season goes fast because you're just trying to get ready for that match, and you have kids that maybe aren't competing for whatever reason. Maybe they're sick, or they're, you know, they're not feeling great, or they're injured or something, but that's just, I feel like that's the way it is every year, you know, it just still comes down to if you want to do well at the Big Ten or the national tournament, you still just have to compete well in the big rounds and win the big matches. It always comes down to that. So just making sure our guys are just know that that's when we are at our best. And even if we aren't, if they think we are, then it works out sometimes.
Guy like Aaron Brooks had to change weight classes, moved up to 197. So for the most part, it's a new set of opponents, challenges that go with it. What's important when a guy makes a move like that, and how has he handled it compared to maybe some other people have over time?
Yeah, we've had a lot of success with our guys moving up weight classes. Aaron's done really well, and he just has his body. He can just, you know, kind of blow up in a good way, just get big and strong really easily. So, you know, he'd been talking about moving up to 197 for a few years, so it wasn't really much of a surprise. But he's done really well, and he's been dominant up to this point. But, you know, you got to just finish strong, and there's still a lot of great wrestlers in the weight class. So he's just got to be himself. But he's done a really good job. I mean, he still has to be disciplined and work hard to get his weight down before his matches. So I think that you just see that a lot with kids, regardless of what weight they are. Mm-hmm. It seems to be difficult for them to make weight.
Is there a challenge because it's new opponents, like he doesn't have a previous scouting report on guys just because he hasn't wrestled them that often? And what does that take to then, you know, come up with your game plan versus their game plan with somebody you don't know?
Yeah, I mean, I think there's that's exciting. I think that's fun for athletes to move into different weight classes, and mm-hmm. because he'd wrestled the same guys at the lower weight, and one of the more familiar opponents is it moved up also. So,
right.
But I think it's fun for them. I think there's unique challenges in wrestling new opponents, and there are challenges in wrestling the same person over and over again, mm-hmm. right? So. But we just try to focus and get them to focus more on what they do and just trying to improve and not worry so much about winning the next match, but trying to just keep getting better, you know, so they can try to separate themselves from their opponents.
What have you seen in Bo Bartlett's progression year to year as to where he is now?
Yeah, he's been fun to watch. No, just his confidence and just the way he learns and he does things. He's obviously a really good kid and a great leader, just always smiling, one of those guys. But, yeah, just watching him improve every year has been it's been fun as a coach. Mm-hmm. You know, he's definitely a student of the game, and everybody's unique. Everybody's different. But he's definitely, you can see pretty clear progress in what he's doing and what he has done. But he's been wrestling really great this year.
I mean, everybody's on their own clock as to when everything kicks in. When did you start to sense and see in him that things were really kicking in for him?
Well, I think from the beginning, he kind of filled in because of the COVID and everything. He right. jumped up and was wrestling 149, and he didn't weigh 149 back then.
Right.
And but you would still see just really outstanding things, and he was in the match with everybody. And last year you saw him take a jump, and then he had a fantastic national tournament where he finished third and did it dominantly coming back through the consolation. And I think that just gave him a lot of confidence. But just little things with technique, because he's extremely athletic, and when action takes place, whether it's his opponent or his, he generally comes out on top. So, you know, he's just the guy you want to see engage as much as possible, and just you know, he's great at landing like a cat in scrambles, and his bottom position's gotten a lot better this year, which I think gives him more confidence to take more risks on his feet too.
Yeah. Where did you see the improvement from year to year in Levi Haynes?
I think Levi I mean, he started out strong for us last year. We were just kind of playing with getting him in the lineup, and really my concerns with him was just is the weight class, is it too low for him?
Mm-hmm.
You know, you don't know, is he still growing? Where is he gonna end up? But he's really disciplined, and he's done a great job with his weight, and it hasn't been an issue. He was just very just poised and did a great job last year. You know, national runner-up as a true freshman. This year, he started out a little slow because he kind of got hurt early in the season, and it took him a little time. And I think he was maybe, you know, trying to be perfect in how he was wrestling instead of just kind of just getting out there and hustling. But he's been wrestling really, really well, especially the last, I'd say, since the Christmas break, which gave him some time to get healthy. But he just keeps getting better. He's just got that mentality, and he's a competitor.
What do you think some of the lessons that Braden Davis has learned to this point?
Well, I think he's just come a long way. He's just a scrappy kid. He kind of started the season out strong, and we were obviously excited about what he's doing and what he is doing and what he's capable of. But I think he had a couple losses there late. But I think when you're a true freshman, that experience is really, really helpful, you know. And I think he was probably feeling and, you know, had some pressure on him. And he's another guy who's got to be really disciplined in managing his weight. And it makes a big difference how he competes when he does things the right way. So, but I think he's really excited about the postseason here. And that's a weight class where, you know, really whoever just goes out there, and I mean, it's the same with every weight class, right? Whoever scores the most points wins. But he can be right in the money there, right in the mix as a true freshman. That's got to be really exciting for him. It's exciting for us.
Cale, you've got a little time between now and the Big Tens, and people, of course, want to know what that can mean for somebody like Carter Storace.
He has a little extra time, and then, you know, another week between the Big Ten and the Nationals, so he has some time to get healthy. But he's doing pretty well. I'd say he's doing better than we feared right away. Mm-hmm. And he's in really good hands with our trainer, Dan Monthly. So, like I've said, we're very optimistic, and Carter's just a tough kid. He's had adversity in every season. You know, he's, mm-hmm. you know, injuries has been a big part of his career, unfortunately, even in high school. I mean, he was a little under the radar even then because he wasn't dominating on the scoreboard, but a lot of times he was also injured. So mm-hmm. he's a tough kid, and he's dealt with some adversity in the past. So if anybody can do it, he can.
You brought up Dan Monthly. I mean, trainers do so much work. How invaluable has he been to the program year after year?
Yeah, he's spot on. You know, when we're on the mat, you know what he says. I trust him 100%. He's always been right on the money as far as like diagnosing some kind of an injury, a knee or a shoulder, and whether, you know, the kid can continue or not. And he's good too. Sometimes I look at him and ask him if we should throw the brick or not, because he knows better than we do. Because we're more emotional, you know, we kind of see what we want to see, where he can sit back there and be like, yeah, no, don't throw the brick. I'm like, all right, give me that brick back.
Aaron McGowell, it looks like he's become better on his feet. What has he done to make himself better when he's in that neutral spot?
Yeah, he's just very athletic and extremely fast. You know, I mean, if you watch him wrestle, he's darting around. You know, I think the more time we have with him, I think he can be a very, very dominant college wrestler. He's one of those guys, too, that's been dealing with sickness, and it's kind of been multiple things in a row for him, but he's really excited here about the postseason, and he's a big match. Like, he'll be a gamer. He's ready to go, but as good a kid as they get. You know, does everything you ask him to do. Yeah. Works really hard, very disciplined, and he's got a lot of skills. So I wouldn't count him out of anything. I know he's had a couple losses in the last couple months, but he's going to be good to go.
Richard Messenbrink. You talk about bringing energy to the table. What do you like about that energy part of it? And are there times where he needs to channel it?
I'm fine with him not channeling it.
Good.
You know?
Good.
We love his energy. He's the same all the time. You know, he comes into our offices a lot during the day and just kind of hangs out and talks and just high energy. Very happy person, and anyone that you have around that's got that good positive energy, it's just good for everybody. He's a great example, and I've heard some of the kids on our team say, hey, I want to wrestle like that guy, you know, and some of them, it hasn't really worked out for him too well, so we're saying, hey, you just wrestle like what you do, and we'll work on that in the off season. Mitchell.
So those are the ones you're telling you need to channel.
Yeah. He's awesome. He loves wrestling. He loves competing, and he's constantly trying to get better. And he's just a kid that grew up wanting to come to Penn State too. So it's fun to have kids like that in your program.
Yeah, no question. Greg Kirkfleet at heavyweight. You know, even in subtle improvements, what are you seeing with him?
He's ready. You know, this. I tell him all the time he's the best heavyweight in the world, and I believe that. You know, I have to get thrown around by him sometimes, but he's wrestling great. You know, he can kind of do what he wants to do. He's confident in his conditioning. He's good on top, bottom, neutral. So just a great athlete. He has a ton of experience, and you know, so hopefully he can end the season where he wants to be, and that's as the national champ.
Bernie Truax, as his time has gone, what have you seen as he's fought his way through a couple of ups and downs and a couple of very close matches that have gone both ways?
Yeah, I think Bernie's another one of those kids. He's just a great kid, and he's happy to be here. You see him smiling all the time, and from the beginning, he's kind of said, "I'm a guy who, I kind of peek at the NCAA tournament. I get everything lined up for that." But he's wrestled great. I mean, he's had a couple losses, but sometimes that happens. Yeah. I mean, we've had some guys that. We just have a really good team, and I think he's picking up a lot of energy around those guys around him, the Carter and Aaron being after him, and Mess and Brink and everyone else, Levi. I mean, that's a pretty good little row of wrestlers there. So I think he's feeding off of them and gives him confidence. I think he's always done really well and kind of peaked at the end of the season, and that's something that gives him confidence.
Do you recruit a transfer the same way, the same method as you do as somebody who's a senior or junior senior in high school, or is there a different way of talking to a transfer when they're thinking about coming here?
That's a good question. I think for us in just recruiting in general, I think you just try to be really transparent and honest and see, hey, this is what we offer, and these are the guys we have. I mean, more for the transfers, they're coming in with maybe one year. Yeah. Aaron and Mitchell, have multiple years, but a guy like Bernie has 1 year. And I think when somebody looks at our lineup and they think, hey, I can wrestle for Penn State at this weight. Yeah. That's kind of what we had, and those guys. So I think the key is just being honest with the kids and just. Kind of just walk them through it and what's important to you and what you're looking for. Is this a good fit? Because even in recruiting, I feel like over the years, you just want to get the kids that want to be here. If you have to spend just endless amounts of time trying to convince somebody to come to school here, they usually doesn't always end up working out. Sometimes it does. Sometimes it does. But we've had cases where it doesn't. So, and our kids that really want to come here are the ones that end up doing the best for us.
I mean, I know you're locked in on the Big Ten's, that I understand, but I want to ask one final question. It's about the U.S. Olympic Trials. What does it mean to get the U.S. Olympic Trials here for the community and also for what you're doing with Nittany Lion Wrestling?
We're excited about the trials. It's been many years in the works. We had them before when they were canceled because of COVID, but we have several athletes that'll be competing there, some of our college kids, and the United States in freestyle wrestling right now is just really good.
Yeah.
So it's going to be a great show, and it's going to be very competitive. Obviously, I don't look at it as let's go have a good time. I just want our guys to make the team.
Yeah, right.
Because you just know how important it is. It only comes around every 4 years, and so it's one of those things. You just got to go get it. It's the shot. It's do or die kind of a thing. Mm-hmm. Try to present that in a more positive way, but yeah. It's just the way it is. You either get it or you don't. So you hope that your guys show up and wrestle at their best.
Cale Sanderson. This half hour brought to you by good friends at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Kia, Routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com here on News Radio 1070 WKOK. All right, there's nothing like Penn State wrestling, and there's nothing like a sit-down with Cale Sanderson. Really isn't. It's the intelligence of the man, the focus of the man, the team-oriented part of the man, the standards of the man. He brings all the right traits to the table. He embodies excellence, and it's great to always have a sit-down one-on-one with him. And hopefully you got something out of it. We just, look, we talked about the team. Like, there's only so often, and I just want to point out that this half hour is brought to you by our good friends at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury, Sunbury Motors, Kia Routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. Too often when people get an opportunity to sit down with him, they want to talk to him about legacies and championships and dynasties and things like that. It's like, that's adorable. But that's not what the guy wants to talk about. So, we sat down and we talked about his team. when you're around people that are forward thinking, and I've been fortunate to be around a lot of really terrific forward thinking people. Joe Paterno, forward thinking person. Russ Rose, forward thinking person. Right? Cale Sanderson, forward thinking person. James Franklin, forward thinking person. And when you're around forward thinkers, they don't sit there and dwell on what's been done. If you want them to sit down and talk, you talk to them about what they have at the moment and what's coming up. And that's that. When you're around forward thinkers, they want to talk about forward thinking in the moment and forward thinking ideas. They don't want to sit there and dwell on what's happened before. Oh, you know, what does this do for your legacy? Like, I don't know. I'm trying to win this week. What? Hope you enjoyed it. Today's show brought to you by Sunbury Motors.
Bringing you an in-depth look at Penn State sports and more. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. The Steve Jones Show is presented by Purdy Insurance, Brewers Outlet, NIL Game Changers, and Sunbury Motor Company. Now from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
And today's show brought to you in part by Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury, the beverage supermarket, imports, domestics, microbrews, the best selection of beer anywhere, wine coolers, water, soft drink, snacks. They roast their peanuts fresh and hot every day. Six great flavors of slushies. And the pickle bar led by the barrels and the dills, my two favorites. Indeed, second to none. All at Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury, the beverage supermarket. And we're in the Sunbury Motors studio, Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Kia, Routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. So, Todd, we will ask you this question based on the Dartmouth vote. What percentage of the American workforce is unionized?
12.
Too high.
Oh.
All right, so let's go back to 1983. In 1983, the percentage of those, okay, in the workforce that were, okay, that were unionized in 1983, 20.3%. So one out of every five, okay, one out of every five happened to be in a union. Today, the overall union membership, it was 10.1% in 2022. It fell to 10% even in 2023. It's been a steady decline. In the 50s, a third of the private sector workforce was unionized. And in 2023, only 6% of private sector workers belonged to unions. Now, the public sector, greater. Private sector, 6%. 94% of the private sector is non-unionized. Now, did we see some union uprisings last year? Yeah, the writer's strike, the actor's strike, right? We saw that finally all get resolved. But now you've gone from one out of every five being in a union to one out of every 10 being in a union. And if you're in the private sector, it's only 6%. Now, many people hold unionization, based on polling, in high regard. Right? But they aren't a part of a union. They aren't a part of it. But when it comes to union membership, it's 10% in this country right now. I think I said it was 20.3 in 1983. It's actually 20.1. My apologies. Now, the number of people in the labor force, of course, has increased. But in 1983, there were 17.7 million union workers. Okay, the number of wage and salary workers belonging to unions in 2023, 14.4. So you have 3.3 million fewer. The union membership rate of public sector workers is about 1 in 3, 32.5%. Private sector, 6%. The highest unionization rates are in education, training, and library occupations, and then protected service occupations. Okay. Non-union workers, median weekly earnings that were 86% of working, of those who are working, non-union workers had median weekly earnings that were 86% of the earnings for workers who were union members. Highest union membership, Hawaii and New York. Hawaii at 24.1%. New York at 20.6%. North and South Carolina the lowest. In South Carolina, only 2.3% are part of a union. North Carolina, 2.7%. So there you go. I mean, again, we see unionization, and it's talked about a lot, but the reality is 9 out of every 10 people who are working are not in a union. Now, as to whether athletes are employees, again, this brings with it a series of interesting questions. You're going to get the good, right? Look at everything they put in. Look at all the people they put in the seats. I happen to see on Twitter from Michael McCann, they did a video of Dartmouth being introduced at home last night. Okay. There was, to say there would be very few people in the stands might be an overstatement. Again, let's go back to what you talked about. Say each one got paid $10,000. And I don't know what they're looking for. I have no idea. So you said $10,000. We asked the suit. He said $1.95. It's just, again, that's the management side coming out. But at $10,000 at 15 players, including walk-ons, you have 13 scholarship players, 2 walk-ons. That's $150,000. If you take the average ticket price of a Dartmouth basketball game times the average attendance, it comes out to $133,000. Now, do they get some money from the Ivy League TV contract? Yes. Do they also get money from the NCAA men's basketball tournament? Yes. They do. They get a share. Everybody gets a share. I don't know. My guess is they have a local radio contract, but it's probably, if there's any money involved in it, I'd be surprised.
Those ticket prices are going up if they have to pay those players. At least you know that.
Well, the attendance is going down then. Okay. They're a 6-21 team. Okay. Not exactly filling out the season ticket form as we speak. It's like, I mean, I'll pick a game, a couple of games here and there. Like when the biggest draw for them, just because of quality of opponent, when Princeton comes to town.
I was going to say Princeton.
Yep. Princeton comes to town. They get a pretty good crowd there. But now I'm the athletic director at Dartmouth. I already have a lot of sports to begin with. In fact, I believe between club sports, between IM's club sports and varsity sports, 75% of the students on the Dartmouth campus participate in sports of some form. Club, varsity, IMs. All right. The problem's going to be with the varsity sports. If now, let's take the California case. That's U.S. The plaintiff is looking for judgment from the NLRB against USC, the Pac-12, and the NCAA. The Pac-12 and the NCAA happen to be private entities, which, of course, except for UConn and Notre Dame would be affected, but UConn football and Notre Dame football would not be affected because they're independent, but they're part of the NCAA, so they're affected. See what I'm saying? And that's the issue with this. If that case goes, then you're going to have a unionization movement that may take place across college sports. All right, well, if that happens, that happens. You know, Beaver Stadium has 110,000 people in it. They have a TV contract that is part of the Big Ten, which is huge. They have a brand new radio and marketing agreement coming up with Playfly, which is part of the mix. So you're saying, you know, look, we draw X amount of people, you know, we should get paid. Hey, we draw X amount of people, money, we should get paid. Well, there's a long list of people, including the people we just interviewed on the show, that their sport doesn't make money. Right? The sport doesn't make money. Right? And when you're talking about the base numbers, take wrestling, for example. You can't include the Nittany Wrestling Club in there. It's like, it's not like, and as an athletic department, wrestling is wrestling. Okay? Right? That's what the product you see out there. On the plus and minus ledger, despite everything, they're on the minus side. And they got everything going for them. The best coach, the best wrestlers, the best fans, sellouts, everything like that. But, of course, the lack of a media deal is a big part of it, all right? But that tells you if that sport is in that spot, where are the other sports? And now if I have to start, I remember when they had to do cost of attendance, which added another 2 to 3 million to the ledger at Penn State. Well, imagine what it's going to add to the ledger if you have to now treat them as employees that are unionized. Now, each state also has labor laws. Some are right-to-work states. New Hampshire, for example, where Dartmouth is, guess what? You can fire union employees. Like, you start reading more into this, like going, okay, right? So what do I do now with other sports? There's only, again, I keep pointing this out. There's only so much money. Remember we were talking about Florida State the other day? And Florida State, we could go to the Big Ten. We go to the SEC. Well, the Big Ten and the SEC would have to come up with more money to make it happen. Oh, they could easily do that. They can? Really? Are the networks a bottomless pit of money? Oregon and Washington got into the Big Ten and they took half. And they asked Fox to front that half. Okay, the SEC and the ESPN, my understanding is Texas and Oklahoma are not getting the full cut this year. Because ESPN can't afford to do it. Now, the year after, they already had planned for it they were going to be in, but they're not fronting money on that. These are not bottomless pits here of money. What are they going to do about the NCAA basketball tournament? That, I mean, that contract runs out in 2032. What's next after that? I mean, there's a lot of questions that come up with this. And again, we talked about the base numbers at Dartmouth. If you're paying each basketball player $10,000 a year, okay, and then again, we're just using round numbers, that's $150,000. Well, that's $150,000 they're not paying now. Well, Dartmouth is only getting a ticket return of $133.
Steve Jones Show, this is Todd's.
You know, and so that's, I mean, these are all questions you have to ask moving forward. And again, I'm not begrudging anybody getting money. I am not in any way, shape, or form begrudging anybody getting money. Nope. But when something like this happens, you always have to then start going through what are the unintended consequences and at least discuss it. Right? But I don't begrudge anybody getting money.
Hey, Steve.
Yeah.
Bob from Hanover's on the line.
Hello, Bob. How are you? First of all, how are you feeling, Bob? You feeling great?
Fabulous.
Great. Love to hear that.
Yep. Thank you. The thing that confuses me about all of college sports today is, why is it when you talk to the big schools, Penn State, one of them, athletics is always separate from the university. However, when it comes to certain things, we're considered a state school, but all the athletics is done independently, isn't it?
Depends on what state you're in.
Our state.
Yeah. Well, it depends. Again, it depends on the university and the institution, what they do. There are a lot of state-related universities that take a share from the university at large. It just turns out that Penn State happens to be one of those where the attempt has been made to do it autonomously. That doesn't mean they haven't taken, you know, money from the university that they have to pay back, which they
do. I'm actually concerned with, why don't the university take a portion of the profits from the athletic department to help student tuition for Pennsylvania residents, which is the whole purpose for Penn State University, to educate Pennsylvania residents.
Why don't they take it from athletics?
Yeah.
Well, they do.
Why
well,
not?
Actually, they, not for academics, but there has been money that's gone from athletics toward the university. I'll give you an example.
Never heard of it. But
oh, I can do this in a heartbeat. Okay.
All right.
All right. What about $4 million of the Big Ten network contract, which you're allowed to do, was taken and put toward the New Palmer Museum of Art. It did not go into athletics. All right? So part of that, and that's part of how they did the financing for the Palmer Museum of Art, which is...
Well, that's another confusing mess. But
right. But it's in the contract. You're allowed to do it. So it's not, that's not out of the realm. All right? All right? When Penn State plays basketball in the Jordan Center, they have to pay rent to another section of the university that runs the Jordan Center.
No, I understand that.
Right. Okay, that's going back. Guess what? That's not staying athletic. That's going back the other way. Like, these are things that aren't...
I understand that.
Right. So, immediately, those are two areas right off out of the gate where athletics has sent money the other way. Also, athletics pays tuition, room and board, to the university for all of these athletes that are there. So there is
money
for
the athletes, but not for the general Pennsylvania resident. The problem I see is the university has recently been cutting staff. They've been cutting stuff from the academic side, yet the athletic side keeps exploding with administrative positions, which cost money. If they would cut that down, then there would be more profit at the end of the year that they could turn over and say, hey, university, look what we did for you. We're helping to cut down on costs of... If you look at the mission statement of the university, it's for Pennsylvania residents to get an education.
Mm-hmm.
We're ignoring that.
Well, athletics is not supposed to be a for-profit group. I mean, it's supposed to be. That's why they keep it plus minus within a rainy day fund.
Well, I don't know. I would debate that issue, but I just think that the
Bob,
university.
Hey, Bob, in COVID it poured.
Oh, I know that. There's always extreme circumstances that happen,
They lost a lot. They lost a lot of money.
Yeah, but we seem to be okay now with the athletic side.
Well, you're still paying back some of that stuff. I mean, there's still payback that happens.
Yeah. I'm just saying, I think the whole college sports world has gotten screwed up because college is pretty much administration, the academic side, pretty much lets the athletic departments do what they want rather than saying, okay, we're going to give you this much money to operate on. We'll let you run sports, but profits you make from that goes back to the university, and we decide how we're going to fund the athletic side. Now, I know that's going to impact how competitive you are with other schools, but why don't, and I'm just speaking gibberish here, why don't the university presidents across the country realize that they've created a problem and they can't get out of it now?
Well, first of all, if I'm a university president, I like the fact that there's autonomy financially with my athletic department.
Why?
It's one less thing I have to worry about.
No, but you have potential to make more money to help the cost of the academic side of the university, which is the mission statement of all public universities, state-related.
Bob, the vast majority lose money.
Well,
I'm talking about the vast
majority. But they don't have to.
Well, and if I'm going, like, the vast majority of programs lose money, only football and men's basketball make money.
Right, I understand that.
Right, and then
they cut 50% of their administrative staff, which we didn't have 10, 15 years ago, we'd be making more money of a profit on the athletic side.
Maybe, I don't know, but not for you'd still be losing money on 29 sports.
Well, that could be. I mean, I look at the program for the whole athletic department. We got multiple pages of administrators now. When I started in the late 70s, not an athlete, there was very few administrators in college athletics.
Yeah.
It's gotten out of control, and I don't know how you possibly get it back.
That part I really can't speak to. I mean, I remember, believe me, I go back when the athletic department had, you know, Jam Bortner and a few, I go back to when they had a limited number of administrators. I know that. But it's today, there's so much more to manage, and it has become a behemoth. I mean, when you are Pat Kraft,
I understand it's a behemoth, but I think it's a behemoth that has gotten totally out of hand.
Well, you're a CEO. You're a CEO of a nine-figure organization.
All right, give the university some of that money.
Yeah, but
not the athletic side, but give it back to what our purpose is. I guess that's my problem I have with it right now.
You want to know where some of the extra money's going right now? Some of the extra money, and Pat, I know, has talked about this, but let's take, for example, chartering. For the first time ever, the men's gymnastics team chartered to Nebraska. I was in the terminal that day because men's basketball is going to go after them. It's the first time ever. Those young people were thrilled beyond words.
Well, I bet.
that they didn't have to take commercial here. I mean, Kale Sanderson, for years, in his own way, kept asking to charter, right, to get them back, right? It's not only a competitive advantage, but get them back academically as well. So the money's being put back into the young people and not just into administrators, Bob. Over and over again, money's being put into young people, right? When you get a better training room, money's being put back into the young people. And I'll give you an example, Bob. In basketball years ago, You know, you have a hot tub and a cold tub, right?
Right.
So let's go back 10 years ago. You know what the cold tub was at Penn State in basketball? I
have no idea.
Kiddie pool that they put ice in. I'm not joking. I was there.
I believe you.
Right? So now they at least have, you know, whatever the cost that is. But it's better for recovery of an athlete. So that's the money's being put back into athletes more often than not, not just a list of administrators. Okay? And I think that's the part that needs to be discussed more, because the long list of administrators is something that people can see. The parts I'm talking about are things that people don't see and should be talked about more.
Oh, yeah, I agree with that. There's a lot of stuff that's not disclosed that probably should be for all people.
Thank you, Bob.
You're listening to News Radio 1070 WKOK Sunbury. You can hear us anywhere in the world with the Sunbury Broadcasting Corporation app.